Hey, this series is called A2 Radio, and today is the last installment in this series. And I'm calling this message Anthem. And if you want the big idea is going to come up on the screen right now. This is the big idea for today's message. An anthem is a song that identifies a group or a movement and inspires them to take action and do what's necessary. Relationships are like that. Relationships, great ones, remind us of who we are, why we're here, that we belong, and that we actually matter. Great relationships are an anthem. Amen. Now, that's the theme for this morning's talk. Look at that first sentence. An anthem is a song that identifies a movement or a group of people, and it inspires them to take action and do what's necessary. So, hey, do something with me for a few moments. You can take that down, David. For instance, when you hear this song, when you hear this rendition of this song, what group of people does this song identify? Hit it, Randy. Stop it right there. Yeah, I know the military men feel an inclination to immediately stand. That is the Star Spangled Banner, the national anthem sung by none other than Whitney Houston. It was recorded in 1991 at Super Bowl 25. It is greatly believed to be the greatest rendition of that song in live recording music history. And it feels somewhat disrespectful to cut the song off. And I'm only cutting it off for the sake of time. But that song, I mean, you hear it for an instant. And here's what happens. People begin standing. An ovation begins to occur because that song reminds us of our history. It reminds us that even though our history is somewhat checkered and spotted, we have a noble calling. We have an incredible purpose. And our country for years has served as a beacon of light. So that's what an anthem is. Now we're going to get a little riskier for the next few moments. And let me just ask you, when you hear the first lines of this, quote, anthem, what group does this identify? Go ahead, Randy. Stop it right there. I don't want anybody to start throwing anything at the stage. Yeah, we haven't had a lot of reason to play that anthem in a few years. Some of you say, what group does that identify? I'm not certain it identifies anybody anymore. That's Rocky Top. We'll get a little less risky. What about this one? What group of people does this anthem identify? Go ahead, Randy. Now, the Auburn fans ought to be making some noise in this room right now. Thank you. You can stop it right there. Jordan, you are brave, my man. Way to go. Jordan Narcates, Auburn fan. Okay, a lot less risky, but when you hear the opening lines of this anthem, who does it identify?
One, two, three.
Oh, yeah. You don't even have to be an Alabama fan to love it, right? Come on. Stop it right there. I don't want to hear that Roll Tide Roll right now. Now, this is really cool. And by the way, my allegiance is Tennessee. I was born, bred, raised there, but I've been in Alabama so long. I'm now a part of your constituency, if you'll allow me to be adopted into that Crimson family. So hats off to you. Google most popular rock anthems of all time. And on any list you Google, this assortment of songs will undoubtedly come up. And let's be really quick on the cue. We're going to go real fast through this cue, so keep them lined up. But it begins. And by the way, it's really interesting to me that all of these rock anthems occur. They were written and recorded in a brief seven-year window between about 1977 and 1984. And they include songs like this. Go ahead and hit it. Oh, come on now. Yeah, I wish it was louder. Come on, yeah, even louder. Oh, oh, come on.
Born down
yeah.
In a dead man's
By the way, that song is a very depressing song. It is. Listen to the lyrics, and it's not really soul enriching. Next one, Randy. How about this one? This one shows up on everybody's list. Oh yeah. Come on. I mean, this is Rocky II, right? And you've got to go ahead. Boom, boom, boom. Oh, yeah, stop it right there. That shows up on everybody. I feel like I'm a fighter when that song occurs. How about the next one? Oh, my goodness. Yes. Stop right there. Some of you are like, some of you are like, can't listen to another thing he says. He knows the guitar licks of AC/DC's Back in Black. Let's do two more maybe, Randy. How about the next one? This shows up on everybody's list. Oh, yes. My favorite band of all time. One of the greatest songs ever written. And one of the greatest guitar licks. Oh yeah. If I could play it, Alan, I would. Stop right there. That song is a good song. How about one more for the people who need a lighter touch? Go ahead, Randy. I was just waiting on this one. Just a few vocals by the great.
Just a small town girl.
Oh, stop it right there. Because people will start taking out their lighters. The greatest rock anthem in history. Now, obviously, this is somewhat subjective, so Ben, get ready. Somewhat subjective, was recorded in 1977. Now, here's the history behind the song. The song is 42 years old. 42 years old. Brian May, lead guitarist of Queen, experienced a show just outside of London, England. And he said in that show, something happened that had never happened up until that moment. He said this was in the era around 1975, 1977, Led Zeppelin, The Who. They were all the rage. And he said people would go to shows and they would bang their heads to the rock music, but nobody sang because singing wasn't cool. He said this particular show, everyone in Bingley Hall, I believe it's called, they were singing out loud the lyrics to our songs. And he said, that moved me. And he said, what moved me even more, we went off the stage waiting for the encore, and all of a sudden, spontaneously, the crowd began to sing the lyrics of the fight song, the theme song for a local soccer team out of Liverpool. He said, I listened to this crowd break into spontaneous song, and I thought, oh my gosh. Why would we ever fight that? Why don't we embrace it? I thought about congregational crowd singing. I went home. He said, I dreamt about it all night and woke up the next morning with the idea for We Will Rock You in my mind. The simple, everybody knows the simple rhythm. Stop, stop, clap. Stop, stop, clap. Stop, stop. Almost only percussion. Until the last 45 seconds of the song, than a soaring, searing guitar solo. May said a story came immediately to mind. Most of us only know the chant, "We will rock you." But the song has three verses, and those verses are powerful. They tell the story of a man named Buddy. Story begins, he's a boy. He's a boy with a dream, a boy filled with optimism, a boy who senses he has a purpose. And he wants to achieve that purpose, but life kicks him in the teeth. He ends up with mud on his face, a big disgrace, kicking his can all over the place. Second verse, the boy has now become a young man who's growing into a hard man. He's hard because life has dealt him a lot of hard blows. But deep inside, he's still got this optimism. He's still got this dream. He's still got this desire to make some noise, make a difference, change the world, make it better. But this time, he ends up with blood on his face, a big disgrace, but he still chooses to wave his banner all over the place. Third verse, Buddy is now an old man. He's an old man searching for meaning, searching for peace, still wanting to make a difference, but life has been hard. He still feels like he's got mud on his face, a big disgrace. Somebody ought to put him back in his place. But through it all, Buddy still sings, "We will rock you. I'm going to make a difference. I'm going to make something happen. I'm going to make dreams come true." In an interview with ESPN, Brian May admitted the song is depressing. What's really, really cool is while Brian May, the entire band had been moved by what happened in that hall. So Brian went home and he wrote, "We Will Rock You." Freddie went home and Freddie wrote, "We Are the Champions." On the album, the songs appeared back to back. In fact, when the singles were sent out to radio stations in America, the singles appeared back to back. And often, since Bohemian Rhapsody had been a hit in 75, radio DJs would let the songs play back to back. "We Will Rock You," "We Are the Champions." And that caught on, so Queen usually closed out their shows, playing both before they would sing their rendition of "God Save the Queen." Fast forward 26 years. There are two Christian brothers out in California. They read a poem by T.S. Eliot, and it inspires them. And they, like Freddie, like Brian, are thinking about purpose, thinking about meaning, thinking about how they can make a difference with their life. And they create a Christian anthem that I remember the first time I heard it in around 2003, 2004. I love great rock music, and I thought, that's one of the best rock songs, period. Don't tag it with Christian. It's just one of the best, period. You don't have to put Christian before it to say it's one of the best ever. It's a song called "Meant to Live." Here's what John and Tim Foreman knew. It's almost as if this wasn't the intention. Please don't misinterpret me. I don't know that they had Queen anywhere in their mind when they wrote the song. But it's almost as if John and Tim, the brothers who are the foundation of Switchfoot, are singing back to Buddy. And they're saying, "We know the secret. We know how you can live a life of purpose. We know how you can live a life of meaning. We know how you can survive being kicked in the face, mud on your face, feeling like a big disgrace. And it will never happen with earthside things. It only happens when you come into a relationship with Jesus. And the first time I heard the bridge, we want more than this world has to offer. More than this world has to offer. Everything inside screams for second life. I said, that's us. That's me. I'm all in. I want to be a part." So ladies and gentlemen, are you ready to rock? This is A2 Rock. Give it up for these guys. Give it up for the team one more time. That was awesome. So what does all this have to do with Scripture? Let me break it down for you. And David, I may significantly condense what I want to say. Mark chapter 3, 13, 14. It's the beginning of Jesus' ministry. He appears, he walks on the scene. And Mark 3, 13, 14 says one of the most amazing things about Jesus. And if you can bring those two verses up, would you say these verses out loud and with me? Jesus went up on a mountainside and called to him those he wanted. Let's say it again and look at the underlines. They're significant. Jesus went up on a mountainside and called to him those he wanted. And they came to him. He appointed 12 that they might be with him. And that he might send them out to preach. Now, if you mark in your Bibles, I would put an asterisk, a star, something by Mark 3, 13, 14. Because it ought to blow us away. Back in the late 80s, early 90s, I was traveling, preaching about 300 nights a year in the Southeast. And I went to a little place to preach out in Jasper, Alabama. And the pastor's son shared with me an author that I had not read before. His name, Calvin Miller. Calvin Miller, in fact, went on to become a professor at Beeson for several years before his death. He is a prolific author, pastor, amazing intellect. He passed in 2012. But the pastor's son shared with me a series of books Calvin Miller wrote called The Singer Trilogy. I think the trilogy was written in 1974 or so. That series of books, it's written in the style of C.S. Lewis, J.R.R. Tolkien, and it tells the story of the gospel, the story of the New Testament in allegorical, poetical form, and it gripped me. And in the Singer Trilogy, Jesus appears as the singer, the troubadour. And according to Miller, in his allegorical, poetic license, Jesus sings creation into existence. The singer sings creation into existence. The singer then appears on the scene, and the singer begins to sing the song that has been sung since the world began. And as he begins to sing, he has to square off against world hater, an icon of Satan. World hater walks around playing his pipe, attempting to dull, charm humanity into a stupor. But whenever the singer shows up and begins to sing a song, world hater has to put away his pipe. He can no longer play in the presence of the singer. And the singer's song is compelling. It's compelling. The singer's song brings healing. The singer's song brings forgiveness. The singer's song brings life. The singer's song brings an abundance of things, meaning and purpose and destiny. And I remember reading that book and weeping. It's a series of books. I read all three, the singer, the song, the finale. And I wept because I realized something. Throughout my life, I'd heard the singer singing over me. I'd heard the singer sing through the words and actions of my mom and dad, who loved me, who cared for me, who pointed me to Jesus from the time I was just a few days old. I'd heard the singer sing over me through the actions and love of the little country church I was raised in a little place called Sell Creek, Tennessee, with hardback wooden pews. But as I sat there, I'd been gripped with a song that had been sung over me. When I read that series of books, I realized, oh my goodness, this is what I felt when I lay in my bed late at night and sometimes would just weep and long for Jesus with a passion that for a kid and a teenager is difficult to describe. I knew I'd heard the singer singing over me. And at first, after reading Miller's books, I thought, oh, this is just poetic license. I don't know when it was that I discovered that Miller wasn't taking poetic license at all. That actually those songs were formed out of deep theology that in fact, according to Zephaniah 3:17, God does in fact sing over us. Can I show you that verse? Would you bring that verse up, David? Zephaniah 3:17, it's the last screen I gave you. And it reads like this, "For the Lord your God is living among you. He is a mighty Savior. He will take delight in you with gladness. With his love, he will calm all your fears." And when you say the last line out loud and together with me, "He will rejoice over you with singing." You've got to say it again. Would you say it out loud? "He will rejoice over you with singing." One more time. "He will rejoice over you with singing." Now, let me mix all of this gumbo up and try to present it in a fashion that is actually tasty. Brian May wrote lyrics about a young man searching for meaning and destiny and purpose. And during his life, he never achieved it. He always felt like he had mud on his face, a big disgrace. Somebody ought to put him back in his place and say, "Buster, it's a pipe dream." Jesus, Mark 3, 13-14, shows up on the scene. And he looks at a group of guys who felt exactly the way Buddy would later be described in that song by Queen. A group of guys who all their life they'd been passed over. See, in that era, if you're going to be chosen by a rabbi to do something significant, to make a dent in this world, to make a difference on this planet, you would have been chosen by your 13th birthday. Not one of the guys Jesus called to himself in Mark 3:13 were chosen by their 13th birthday. They all had been passed over. But they lived with this ache, this longing. We were meant for something more. There's got to be more than this. Fishing is a noble vocation. And we're meeting a real need in our community when we fish. At least 7 of them may have been fishermen. We know for certain 4 of them. And we can guess that an additional 3. One of them was a zealot who hated Rome with all the passion in him. That was. Anybody heard of the zealots that existed in the first century? One group of them were called Sicarii. Anyone seen the film Sicario or its follow-up? It means assassin. It means that dude, Simon the Zealot, was a bad dude. You didn't mess with Simon. Guess what Jesus does? He sees something great in Simon, who may have not necessarily been, but he may have been a Sicarii. And he calls Simon to himself and he thinks to himself, "I'm just going to make this really interesting because I'm going to put right beside Simon a potential Sicarii, Matthew, an absolute traitor. Let's let them mix it up. I'm going to remind them that they were meant for something more." What's Jesus' method of discipleship? What's Jesus' method of relationship? 3 things that all come right out of those verses in Mark 3:13 and 14. Bring up the first one, if you would. This is the first thought, if you want to jot it down. This is the first thought of how you can make your relationships an anthem. First thought, be intentional. Do you see it? He called out the ones he wanted to go with him. If you mark in your Bibles, you may want to mark, underline, circle those 2 words, called out, because the Greek word is proskuneo. It means to call out, to invite, to single out. It's this direct: David, I want you. Missy, I want you. If that word proskuneo sounds familiar, it might, because it's also related to the Greek word we get the word church from. The word church in Greek is ekklesia, from two Greek words, ek, to call out, and kaleo, to call or invite. Here's what I'm simply saying to you. If you're a part of the Church of Jesus Christ, and by the way, I'm not speaking of A2 Church in particular. I'm not speaking of First Baptist. I'm not speaking of Briarwood Pres. I'm not speaking of Redeemer Church downtown. I'm speaking of the Church of Jesus Christ that's bigger than any denomination, that's bigger than any location, the church that exists of every, that is made up of every person who is known by Jesus, loved by Jesus, saved by the blood of Jesus. If you're a part of that church, you need to know that as certain as Matthew, Mark, Luke, John heard Jesus say, come on, I want you to be a part of my inner circle. Jesus has actually said to each one of you, Mike, Jolynn, you can't stay where you are. I'm irresistibly drawing you to myself. Derek, Kimberly, you're not going to stay where you are. I'm irresistibly drawing you into my family, saving you by my grace. Kim, you can't stay where you are. You may run, you may try to fight it, you may hide, but I'm going to irresistibly draw you to myself. You need to know that if you know Jesus, it's not because you did something good. It is because Jesus, by his grace, irresistibly chose you, called you, decided that you would be part of his forever family. If you want to make your relationships an anthem, listen to me, you've got to move towards other people with the same intention that Jesus moved towards you with. Did you get that? Move towards people with the same intention Jesus moved towards you with. Jesus didn't see all of your problems. Jesus saw all of the possibilities. Jesus saw your potential instead of seeing all of your failures. Move intentionally toward the people in your life. Number two, you want to make your relationships an anthem. Build the relationship. He appointed 12 that they might be with him. I'm telling you, I can't read that without being moved. He appointed 12. Notice what precedes everything. That they might be what? Relationship precedes mission. Relationship precedes purpose. Relationship precedes calling. Jesus appointed them that they might be with him. Guys, I just want us to hang out. And for 3.5 years, Jesus got as close to a group of men as you can possibly get. They camped out together. They ate together. They experienced disappointment together. They experienced breakthrough together. Hey, they were a group of 13 guys sitting around a campfire. Anybody believe they laughed together? Anybody think somebody among that group of people had to tell at least one fart joke? At least one. I mean, it's a bunch of guys. Now, I know that's too holy for some of you, but it's not too holy for Jesus, because he willingly took upon himself a robe of flesh. He wanted to be with them. So for 3.5 years, they do life together. I think there are at least three bare basics for great relationships that will come up on the screen. Spend time together. Hang out. Not all the time that Jesus spent together with his disciples was, quote, spiritual. It was time together. We need to remember this, that our little demarcations of secular and spiritual may only count to us, that we actually live life imago Dei, under the gaze of God, and under his gaze, every moment is spiritual. Every moment. The time, Derek, that you laugh with those two beautiful children of yours. that you wrestle in the floor and you tickle them until they can't stand it any longer. That's spiritual. Spend time together. Persevere through trials. Something powerful happens when people who are in a friendship or marriage go through trials together. Something powerful that could never happen apart from the trial. I would not choose the trial. I would not sign up for the trial. But on the other side of the trial, I look back and I see God's superintending grace all along, not only bringing us through, but through the process of the trial, bringing us together. Third, grow in trust. Jesus walks onto the scene, begins singing his song, and he calls those he wants to be with him. And they join, they begin to sing the song with him. Then he begins to build the relationship. Why does he take 3.5 years to just be with them? He appointed them to be with him because during those 3.5 years, you know what Jesus is doing? He's rebuilding those men in his image. Right. He's stripping away the buddy ideology. You got mud on your face. You're a big disgrace. You'll just kick your can on down the road another day. Jesus is stripping away all of that. He's saying, oh no, oh no. You were meant for something more. Yeah, life's going to throw mud in your face. Sometimes you'll feel like you're a disgrace, but I want to let you know, you've been called out of darkness into this marvelous light, Peter would later say, and you have a destiny and an identity as the redeemed people of God, created for a noble purpose. So for 3.5 years, I just want to remake you in the image of myself. The image of a God who loves you deeply. Third point. Jordan, you ready? It's going to blow people away that I'm done. Bring up that third one. Believe in and pursue a mission that's bigger than you. He appointed 12 that they might be with him and that he might. Everybody see it? Send them out to preach. Hey, in most romances, I don't remember the last romantic movie my wife and I saw. It's probably an indication that I'm not a great husband in terms of movie selection. We tend to go to action movies. She's a better wife than I am a husband because she relents and goes. But in most romantic movies, best I recall, the climactic moment is some kiss that occurs at the end. It's a moment of romance. Most of us who've experienced those moments know this, that is not sufficient to build a great relationship. It's a good and significant part of a relationship, that moment when you kiss, sparks ignite, sparks fly, you know we were meant to be together. But most of you who've done the marriage thing or any kind of relational thing, you know that moment is not enough to pull us together. This is why Feldhahn, I can't remember her first name right now, pardon me, it escaped me. She's written 2 books on marriage filled with statistical data about what keeps marriages together. And she writes that one of the most important aspects of every relationship is that that relationship have a purpose that's bigger than the relationship. Have a mission that's bigger than the marriage. A purpose that is broad and big and great and grand and glorious. And it's interesting. Jesus calls these 12 men to himself that they might be with him. He wants them to experience the relationship, but he knows they also need meaning and purpose. They need a mission bigger than themselves. And he gives them the biggest mission of all. And we read the book of Acts, Acts chapter 2. What happens in Acts chapter 2? Peter, a dude who had failed massively, stands up on the greatest stage in history, and in a city where days before he had hid for fear of the religious authorities, he stands up and says, "You crucified the Lord of glory, but I'm here to give you witness that God raised him from the dead. I've seen him personally. I know that he's alive. And in doing so, God fulfilled all the messianic psalms, all the messianic scriptures. Jesus is alive. He preached with such authority that people started beating their chest, interrupting his sermon and saying, what can we do to be saved? And that day, 3,000 were born into the kingdom of God. That's mission. That's purpose. And those guys went on to live their mission and purpose until every one of them, except the Apostle John, and I'm not counting Judas among that number, they died martyrs' deaths. They died knowing that they had joined the singer in his song over all creation. And that's a good thing, right? So guys, I want to invite you to join the singer today and begin to sing the song you were meant to sing. A song of redemption, a song of purpose, a song of destiny. If you don't know Jesus, just say this prayer with me out loud, not alone, but out loud. Just say, Heavenly Father, thank you for loving me. Thank you for calling me to yourself. Thank you that even from childhood, even before birth, you were singing over me. In fact, you rejoice over me with singing. So today, I join Jesus in the song he sings. I ask Jesus, forgive my sin. Lead my life. Teach me to sing your song, to live with purpose in this world.